Although the title will probably be different online, it is a continuation of a message we started last week entitled, Why Do Church? And churches come under attack. You know that. Amen. We live in a very independent society. We live in a society where most people don't build front porches anymore because, hey, after all, we're just to ourselves. Amen. We need other people. Amen. All right, cut the tape. But anyhow, so it's going to be kind of a continuation of that, but it'll probably be titled different online because I'm going to focus in on an area, kind of what we talked about Thursday night in our study of the book of 1 John. But I want to say this because I thought this little story really illustrated what I'm trying to say, in the sense that so many times it's the way we see things, amen? What you're looking at, it's how you're seeing it. Is that, if that makes any sense? And this illustrated to me, and when I'm applying this to the body of Christ, the church, and when I say the church, we are the church. I get it, okay? You know, the grace police, they get all over that. You know who the grace police are? That's works. They're the grace police. But anyhow, so I understand that we are the church, but God has called us as a body to not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner some is. And I've often said that the way the enemy likes people to get is to get isolated. You know, because if you get isolated and you don't have anybody you can talk to, then sometimes your mind can start playing tricks on you and the adversary can come in. But anyhow, this is a little story here. It says, a young couple moves into a new neighborhood. The next morning while they are eating breakfast, the young woman sees her neighbor hanging the wash outside. That laundry is not very clean. She doesn't know how to wash correctly. Perhaps she needs better laundry soap. Her husband looks on, remaining silent. Every time her neighbor hangs her wash to dry, the young woman makes the same comments. A month later, the woman is surprised to see a nice, clean wash on the line and says to her husband, look, she's finally learned how to wash correctly. I wonder who taught her this. The husband replies, I got up early this morning and cleaned our windows. And so it is with life. And so it is with life. What we see when watching others depends on the clarity of the window through which we look. Isn't that good? And so I mean, I'm saying all that to say, you know, as we go into this, if you want to sleep during a message, this is not the message, because I'm going to encourage you to respond, because I believe this will help you. Much confusion in the body of Christ, it's based on one thing. It's based on misunderstandings. Amen. In fact, let me show you Matthew 13:19. This is Matthew's account of the parable of the sower. I want you to see this, and then we're going to talk about why do church. And like I said, it'll probably be called something different online for you'll see as we get going. Jesus said, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away or steals away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. Isn't that interesting? When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, but they don't understand it, the enemy is able to steal that word. Well, look at this. Amen. Understand? And he's able to steal that word that was sown in his heart on the inside. He's able to get it out because that person doesn't understand. Amen. Amen. One of the reasons that we do church, one of the big reasons that we do church, is to remind each other as born-again Christians who we are. You know, the saying, right believing produces right living. The flip side of that is, wrong believing produces wrong living. Amen? Amen. And so we need to understand some things. This is one of the reasons. God gave gifts in the body of Christ. We looked at that last week out of Ephesians chapter 4. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. I mean, that was God's idea. You know, as long as we're in this world, guys, we need each other. And I like what Linda says. Guess what? We're going to spend eternity with each other. Amen? No, but you know, when we're in our glorified body, I think things are going to flow really good, because then our body will be in agreement with our spirit. But in the meantime, our spirit is to be in charge. Amen. Our born-again spirit. All right. So with that said, I want to show you a scripture out of 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. For those of you who are here Wednesday, you're going to hear some things, but we'll go in some different areas. Look at 1 John 1:7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, look at this. We have fellowship one with another. I don't care if I can quote the whole Bible. If I can't fellowship with the brethren, I'm not walking in God's light. Amen. It's just that simple. If I could quote the whole Bible, every Hebrew Greek word, I'm just using that. I can't. But if I could, but I can't fellowship with the brethren, the Bible says I'm not walking in his light. But that's really not what I'm after. Here's what I'm after. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Now, this really boggled me for a long time because I thought I was clean. But yet here it says he cleanses me from all sin. And in the Greek, it's even stronger. It's in the present continuous sense. Now, this is really messing me up. Am I clean or am I getting clean? No answer. Okay? Let me tell you, we're gonna understand this, guys. And I'm going to show you different scriptures and I'm going to ask for your participation. We need to understand our vertical walk with God. That's our position in Christ. We are pleasing to God. And then our horizontal walk in this world. Amen. And the Lord showed me this morning. He said, to not have a correct understanding of, or you won't have a correct horizontal walk in this world if you do not have a correct understanding of your position, your vertical position in Christ or who you are. Amen. All right, now that's good. Now, so his blood is cleansing me if I'm walking in the light. But I'm already cleansed, right? I'm born again. I've accepted Jesus. I say it all the time. I believe there's a lot of people many times that are truly born again, but they're on bar stools at different times because they've been so turned off by religion. Amen? Because they haven't seen Christ. All they've seen is a bunch of rules and they've been beat up and abused and all those types of things. And so what's the use, right? Well, they don't know who they are. Amen. This is one of the reasons we do church. This is one of the reasons, okay? So we can experience foot washing. Go to John chapter 13, verse 1. We're going to do 15 verses here. I'm going to show you this. And then I'm going to do a whole bunch of examples. And this is where if you fall asleep, I'll have you kick your neighbor in love. All right. Look at this. This is now before the feast of the Passover. Let me say something here. Well, let me just go down here. Before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. Next verse. And supper being ended, the devil having now put in the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Next verse. And knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he was come from God and went to God, next verse, he riseth from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. Now this is where he begins to wash the disciples' feet. The word towel is a Greek word lenteion. Say that with me, lenteion. L-E-N-T-I-O-N in English. And it means a linen cloth or a linen towel. Now, what does linen represent in Scripture? Can anybody tell me? Righteousness. Revelation chapter 19 and verse 8 says, the fine linen is the righteousness, or actually, the righteous acts, but that's a whole other subject, the righteousness of the saints. Isn't that interesting? Revelation 19 verse 8, I believe it is, says that the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. In the old covenant, they were not allowed, Leviticus 19:19, to have any garment that was mixed with wool and linen. Ezekiel talks about the priests could not have anything that made them sweat. Why? It was a picture or a type that you can't work for this. It's not your righteousness. It's his that's been given to you as a free gift. Amen. Now hang with me. So that this is all significant, all of it. Now it says, he took a towel and he girded himself. Go to the next verse. And he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Now this is interesting. The feet represent our walk. Amen? The feet, when you walk, your feet get dirty. Or in my case, you put holes in socks all the time. I mean, I have the holiest socks you've ever seen. I do. It's a bad habit. I just, and I'm thinking, well, I better stop this because there are going to be holes in these socks also. But I just like to wear socks sometimes. Or if you walk, if the floor's dirty, or if you walk on the ground, guess what happens? Your feet get dirty. Do you know that in our Christian walk in this world, we pick up things that are dirty? And what I mean by that is we pick up wrong ideas, we pick up religion, we revert back. If you don't focus on grace and what Jesus did, if you don't focus on that, works are right back at the door. You'll go right back under the same mindset that thinks God is receiving you and accepting you and blessing you based on your performance or lack thereof, rather than Jesus, what Jesus did. See, you need your feet washed. We'll see this. Let's go on further, please. I'm going to give you a bunch of examples, I think. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, doest thou wash my feet? Next verse, question. In other words, he didn't understand this. You'll see this right here. Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not, or you don't know now, not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Now stop. He said, you're not perceiving what I'm doing now, but you will know hereafter. Think this with me. Think with me. Peter should have said, I know what you're doing. You're washing our feet. But see, this tells me that the significance of the washing of the feet is not about getting the dirt out of your toenails. Amen. There's some significance going on here. Amen. Can anybody see it? That's why he told Peter, you don't know what I'm doing now, but you're going to know later. Hallelujah. Next verse. Now watch this. Peter saith unto him, thou or you shall never wash my feet. Now this is an amazing verse. Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Amazing verse. If your feet aren't washed, you don't have any part with him. It doesn't mean you're not born again. Somebody hear this. It doesn't mean you're not born again. In fact, the word part is the Greek word meros, and it means a part of a whole. In other words, you're not going to participate in what I've made available. It's the same word that's used, watch this verse, Revelation 21, verse 7, and we'll come back here. Watch this. Revelation 21, verse 8. I'm sorry. 8. But the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Now that word there, part, is the same Greek word, part. Now in Revelation 20, he talks about the lake of fire and the final judgment. But this is talking about people who will participate in that judgment in this life. They're taking a part of it. For example, fear. Do you know the word fear the word torment in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18 is the exact same word that's used for everlasting punishment in Matthew 25, 46 when it talks about hell? You know, there's people that are even believers because of unbelief, because of not putting their faith in Jesus, they're partaking of something that Jesus has redeemed them from. What needs to occur? They need their feet to be washed. They need to know who they are. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You're an overcomer. You're blessed. You're successful. No matter what the outward circumstance looks like, that's what God says about you. Agree with it. Amen. Say amen. There, you just agreed. Good job. All right, now back to Revelation 13, or John 13, I believe it's verse 8. There's so much we could say here, but not now. Friday night, the Revelation Bible study. We don't know if we'll get there. All right, Peter saith unto him, you'll never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, referring to his feet, you have no part with me. Amazing verse. So let's go to 2 Peter 1. Watch this verse. And verse 9, I think it is. I've shared this with you a couple weeks ago, but I didn't really go into it. Jesus is talking about adding 7 attributes to your faith walk. Not your position, not your vertical position or who you are, but to your walk. These are all things you have in your position. But he says, if you don't do this, he that lacketh these things, notice this, he's blind, he cannot see afar off, and notice what he forgot. He's forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Back up to verse 8. I'm sorry. I wanted verse 8. That's good anyhow. Yes. For if these things, these seven attributes, be in you and abound, they make you. Somebody say, make you. That you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know believers can be barren and unfruitful in the knowledge of Jesus? You can have a born-again nature. You can have the Holy Ghost. You can have all this information and produce no fruit in your life. But does that mean you're not righteous? Not at all. If you're born again, you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But I'm telling you guys, God wants our vertical walk to manifest in our horizontal walk. People are hurting and crying for the life that you and I have. They are. You know, I've been praying, Lord, give me an eternal perspective. Help me to see things in light of eternity. Help me to live every day like it's my last day. What if you knew that you had 24 hours and you were out of here? You were going to heaven. Wouldn't you do anything different? You're still going to heaven, right? But see, the things we do now are become eternal pillars in eternity. The lives you touch now make a difference. Why are we here? Hear me. Why, after I'm born again, if it's just about me, I mean, imagine the greatest pleasure you can enjoy in life, the greatest meal, the greatest vacation, whatever, winning the lottery. Think about it. If it's all about me, heaven will far trump that. You know that? It'll make that look like nothing. Are you hearing me? You know what that tells me? I got to be here for you. I got to be here for other people. I am here for other people. Part of the joy in this walk is letting the rivers flow through you. Amen. It's exciting to let the love of God compel you to love on people. And it's exciting to let your vertical walk, your relationship with God, manifest in your horizontal walk in this world. All right. Back to John 13. Hallelujah. We're going to get into the test here in a minute. John chapter 13, I believe it was verse 8 somewhere. Simon Peter says, then Peter said, after he said, you have no part in me if I don't wash your feet. I love what Peter says here. Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Do it all, Lord. I got a Greek thing I want to share with you here. Go to the next verse. Jesus saith to him, he that is washed, baptized, born again, immersed in God. Look at this. He needs not save or accept, that's old English, except to wash his feet. But he's clean, every whit or his whole being is clean. And ye are clean, but not all, referring to Judas Iscariot. Now watch this. But he that is washed, he that is born again, you're clean. That's who you are. Amen. What was the example Patty shared with me? The Price is Right. Remember that show? Da-na-da-na. Is that am I the right song? Da-na. Okay, all right. I mean, it's been so long. I mean, I'm thinking Bob Barker. Is he still alive? You know, that's how long it's been for me. But you know, the contestant who guessed the price would come running down and say, I won. Now, what if somebody came out of the outside? Hold on just a minute. You need to have faith. I'm thinking, but they just told me I won. Well, that's what God's telling you and I. You've already got it. Jesus got the price right. You're not your own. You're bought with a price. Amen? But when we realize it, does it change our reaction? Yes or no? When we say yes to it. All right, I'm going to have everybody stand up and act like you just won on The Price is Right. Amen? You're excited, right? Yeah. You just won. You've got it, man. And that's how God wants us to see things. But then when we see things, our vertical position in Christ, it changes our horizontal walk in this world. You know, the love of God is amazing. It is amazing. You know, the more I realize that He loves me, the more I can love people. And I'm telling you, if you live in this world at all, people will jerk you every which way but loose. Amen? They'll rub you the wrong way. And listen, when self is on the throne, I'm easily offended. When he's on the throne, I think, oh, well, praise God, they're not putting me on the cross. At least not yet. Amen. Jesus said, he that is washed, I want you to see this. He that is washed, Jesus said in John 15:3, now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. That's your position. Is that vertical or horizontal? Vertical, now you are clean. Is that vertical or horizontal? Vertical. Vertical, thank you. It's vertical. Through the word, but he says, Jesus said, he that is washed or clean, He needs not except to wash his feet. Now notice he needs to wash his feet. Did you catch that? I don't want to be barren and unfruitful in the knowledge of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This word needeth, that word is two words in the Greek, one verb and one noun. The verb is echo. Everybody say echo. It's actually echo. You got to say it like that, echo. but it means to hold on to. And it's in the present tense, which means it's continuous. You got to hold on to something. It says hold on, and it's chereia is the noun, and it's a singular noun, and it means necessity, need, duty, or business. In other words, it's not optional. It's important that I need to have my feet washed, because as I walk through this world, things come against you to bring you down and to get you looking every which way but to Jesus. Amen? We need that. And we don't need it just once a week or twice a week or once a whatever. We need it daily. Amen. I'm constantly soaking in the things of God. I have to, or I'll go nuts. So will you. Some of you are already nuts. That's why they're so mean. I'm serious. We treat other people the way we believe God's treating us. We do. I'm convinced of that. Amen. All right. So he needs his feet washed. Next verse. We have a few more verses here. For he knew who should betray him, therefore said, ye are not all clean. Next verse. And so after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, know ye what I have done to you? Next verse. Ye call me master and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. Next verse. If I then, your Lord and master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. And now people take this and they make it about having a physical basin of water and a towel. But he's talking about you need to remind people who they are in him. Because the world will not, they're not going to remind you of that. In fact, they're going to tell you, you're nuts. They are. Me and Joel watched the debate last night on YouTube of Ken Ham, the creation scientist down at Creation Museum, and Bill Nye, the science guy. And an atheist, I don't know if he's an atheist. He's a evolutionist, and of course I'm very biased. I will admit that. As far as I was concerned, Ken Ham smoked him. But that was my thoughts. And it was really good. And you know what I loved about what Ken said was he didn't back down from faith. You know, this is the way. I love what he told him. He says, man, if you just live and when you die, you're dead. You go, what's this joy of discovery you're talking about? You know, there is no life outside of Christ. Most people are living lives of quiet desperation, and that's not God's call. I try to pray every day, Lord, who are you calling me to minister to today? It ain't about me. If it's about me, I may as well go to heaven. Reminds me of the street preacher. Years ago, we drove around this little town, and he would holler out the window, real rough. He'd holler out the window, go to heaven! These people in the town, they would look at him. I said, that don't fly in these small towns around here. So, amen? I may as well just go to heaven if that's what it's all about. I look at my life as I'm a missionary. You know that? I'm an ambassador from another kingdom, and so are you. Hey, let me tell you something else that'll set you free. It doesn't have to be a big Billy Graham crusade for you to be successful. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25, when you've done it unto one, the least, you did it to me. Amen. That's good news. That's good news. Every day, I promise you, God's got someone on your heart for you to minister to, for you to disciple, for you to love, for you to reach out to. Maybe more than one. I don't know, but God knows. I think this guy I'm visiting in the nursing home, he told me the other day, he said, I am so glad I met you. And I thought, you know, God, that's awesome. And I'm not bragging on me, I'm bragging on Jesus. I always think, I try to think, you know, most of the time I'm running around like most of us with a chicken with our head cut off. and I was thinking, what if that was me laying in there? And what if I couldn't get out? Would I want somebody to visit and work with me and share the word with me? Sure I would, so would you. Now, see, we're talking about, some people hear this because they don't understand our vertical position in Christ, who we are, we're righteous. They think, oh, no, they think a challenge is condemnation. It's not. It's challenging you to be all that he made you. It is. It's just that simple. You're not trying to get, you're not trying to do something to be something. You already are something. This is washing your feet. You're a minister. You're carrying the life of God in you. Hallelujah. You're an exporter of the kingdom of God. Everywhere you go, you're called to export the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you then have washed your feet, you ought also to wash one another's feet. There, right there is a ministry. I talked to a gentleman the other day and was talking about the things of God. And I'm not kidding you. I tell people, you have no idea how blessed you are to hear the new covenant. There's people, they talk and I'm telling you, it's like, this guy loves the Lord, but he cannot hear the new covenant. And I yearn for him. So I'm working with spirit, soul, and body, trying to get him to see it's not about you. It's about who you are in the spirit. See, you got to see that. See, the church has told people, just do stuff and we don't, and who cares who you are? That's wrong. Let me give one more and then I'm going to show you another verse. Verse 15. If I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. Now jump over to Romans 6:11. Your verse, Patty. Because I want to show you. I want to walk further. Okay, so there's a difference between our vertical walk with God, right? And our horizontal walk in this world. Everybody got that? The vertical walk has to be understood before we will walk correctly in this world. Everybody say vertical?
Vertical.
Horizontal. All right. And when I say vertical, I'm not saying God's up there millions of miles away. He's in you. I'm just saying it as a point of reference, okay? Relating to God. Likewise, reckon ye also. And people that say Paul wasn't Southern, I beg to differ. I'm kidding. King James. The word reckon is a powerful Greek word. Everybody say, logazomai. Logazomai is a Greek word, and it means to account. It means to take inventory. Now, here's what really fascinated me when I looked at this word. Watch this. It's not a one-time act. I thought it would be. I thought for sure this is going to be aorist tense. I know it is. I was wrong. It's a continuous action, present tense. And here's what else is powerful. The verb is in the middle voice. What does that mean? Whenever it's in the middle voice, it's emphasizing that you're getting help to do this. Amen? Subject participates in the action. We're participating with the help of the Holy Spirit. And this is what really got me. It's in the imperative mood. What's that mean? It's imperative. It's necessary. You need to do this. To reckon, to inventory, to account yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin. Now, it's interesting there when you look at sin, it's a noun. It's a singular noun. I believe it's referring to the sin nature. Now, keep this in mind because the next verses are going to mess you up a little bit. But alive, this is, he said, account, reckon, inventory, consistently, constantly, yourselves to be dead indeed unto the sin, sin nature, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Question, is this vertical or horizontal? This verse. Vertical with God or horizontal in this world? Come on. This is where we're going to start getting involved. It's not horizontal. It's vertical. God. It's my relationship with God. It's what God did for me. Amen?
Amen.
Look at this. I'll say it again. To account myself dead unto sin but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord is vertical. It's my relationship. It's what God did for me. Amen?
Amen.
Next verse. Let not sin, therefore, or thus sin, singular noun. Wait a minute. If I don't have a sin nature, and this is talking about the sin nature, then why does it say this? These are questions I ask myself. It's simple. Because even though you're dead unto sin, don't let something that's dead run your life. The word reign means basileia. It's where we get the word kingdom. It's the word for kingdom. And it has to do with don't let something that's dead reign in your life like it's king. Now watch this. Let not the sin reign in your mortal body. Everybody say mortal body. That's this body that we have right now. It's not your immortal body. It's not your glorified body, but it's a mortal body. How many of you know that we fight to keep this thing going sometimes? Amen? I mean, don't, oh, that's a bad confession. No, that's not a bad confession. It's the honest truth. You know what I hate sometimes about us charismaniacs? Is sometimes we act dumb. We do. We act dumb. Like, don't say that. I'll never forget the lady that I was around. She would say, you'd say, take care. Take care. I'm not taking care. I don't take care. I'm not saying take anxiety. Take pressure. Take worry. I'm saying take care of yourself. Be good to yourself. That's how weird we get. Hello, religion. Amen, amen. Take care. Take some anxiety. Here it is. Let not sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Now stop. Is this vertical with God or horizontal in this world? Thank you. But notice verse 12, it follows verse 11. Do you see that? So vertical, horizontal follows vertical. In other words, until I understand who I am in Christ, I'm probably going to have problems with stuff. And none of us understand perfectly, okay? But I'm saying we need to understand our vertical position in Christ, and it's secure and it's a done deal. Something that we were talking about this week I thought was interesting. I'm not going to go there for the sake of time, but in Romans 8 and Hebrews 7, it talks about, first of all, it talks about the Holy Spirit interceding, and then it talks about Jesus' intercession at the right hand of the Father. You know, Jesus isn't trying to convince God to be nice to you, the Father. Oh, come on. Cut him some slack, man. He's trying. Remember my blood, man. Look at the hands. All right, this time. But if he does it one more time. No, you know who he's trying to convince? You and me. Amen. That we're righteous. Amen. 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 We're the ones that need convinced, not God. He already knows. That's why he's the apostle and high priest of our confession, Hebrews 3:1. He's sent. He's proclaiming over you. And it says over. The word for you literally is over. Hooper in Greek. He's interceding over you. Trying to get you to understand who you are in him. You understand vertical position? It'll change your horizontal walk. You don't understand your vertical position? Your feet are messed up. And so is your horizontal walk going to be messed up. Everybody got that? All right. So this is horizontal. Another verse. Neither yield you your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, singular noun, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members, your hands, your eyes, your feet, your ears, as instruments of righteousness unto God. Stop. Is this vertical with God or horizontal in this world? Horizontal. Who said that? It's horizontal. See that? But notice we started with verse 11, hear me, which is vertical. Okay? This is horizontal. Next verse. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, or the law, but under grace. Sin shall not have dominion over you. What is it?
Vertical.
Sin shall not have dominion over you in this world, horizontal. Why? For you are not under the law, vertical, but under grace. I mean, you could look at it different ways, but he's saying, if you understand the position we have in Christ, it'll change the walk we have in this world. Now, let me give you a couple more. Go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. I want to show you this one. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 3. This is life-changing if you get this. I see so much confusion in the body of Christ over this. Do you know that? Watch this. Second, we are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet or proper or fit, because that your faith groweth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you all toward each other aboundeth. Now listen to this. He says that we're thanking God for you, brethren. Your faith is growing. Whoa, wait a minute here. This contradicts some other scriptures. How can my faith be growing if I've already got a measure of faith, Romans 12:3? If I've already got the same spirit of faith, 2 Corinthians 4:13? If I've obtained like precious faith, 2 Peter 1:1? I thought I've already got faith, but here he says my faith grows. Is this vertical or horizontal? Thank you. You're getting it. You're getting it. You can't be more righteous. Let me read this to you. This is from E.W. Kenyon. This is good. From his book, The Hidden Man of the Heart. One cannot grow in righteousness. You can. It's impossible. You can't win the car. You've already won it. Price is right. Remember that. You've already won it. You can't win it. You already won it. One cannot grow in righteousness. He may grow in righteousness, consciousness. But he already is the righteousness of God in Christ. One cannot grow in sonship. One may grow in sonship consciousness and learn to enjoy his privileges and rights in the family. We are the grace of God unveiled. We are sons of God, and as such, we grow into fruit bearing. We increase in usefulness. We can grow in gentleness and tenderness in the beauty of the Master. We may grow in love. You got it? That's good. Now watch this. So, question. This is horizontal, right? In this world. Now let me give you another one. Go to 2 Timothy 2, verse 22. Watch this. Flee also youthful lust. There's where the church stops, right there. Isn't that, am I correct? Isn't this where the church stops, yes or no, as a whole? Absolutely. But notice how you flee youthful lust. By pursuing, following righteousness. That's not to earn righteousness. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. By pursuing an understanding of what you've already got in Him, grace and peace are multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. 2 Peter 1, 2. So here's how you flee youthful lust. By following righteousness or pursuing righteousness, faith, love, or charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Do you see? Can anybody see the difference? The church says, hey, stop it. Why? Because I told you. That's all the reason you need. It's wrong. Amen? Here's how you flee youthful lust, by pursuing righteousness, faith, charity, and peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. That's how you do it. Man, that's good. This is a horizontal walk, but it's based on the position of righteousness, faith, charity, and peace that you have in the Lord. That's how you flee youthful lust. Amen. And is it because God will be mad at you? No, it's because that stuff will hurt you. You know, pornography is as addictive as heroin? A lot of people don't know that. Well, it's quiet in this church, isn't it? Amen. It's an addiction. It'll destroy you. Amen. God, and let me tell you this, God created sex not only for procreation, but for fun. Amen. It's a great thing, but it's like electricity. If it's not channeled in God's direction, in God's way, it can kill you. Amen. See, the thing about those things is they make people self-absorbed instead of the other person absorbed. And it may not get you right away, but it will later. Amen? All right, moving right along. Let me give you some more here. Ah, boy, there's so many good ones here. Go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1. I'm sorry. We're doing good, man. We are doing good. Don't accept the defeat of unclean feet. Let's say that together. Say, don't accept the defeat of unclean feet. Where do those titles come from? I have no idea. I'm not going to blame God. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, we beg you, brethren. Everybody say brethren. Brethren. You know the word brethren is a Greek word. I love these Greek words. I'm a Greek freak when it comes to the language, but it's a Greek word adophos, like Philadelphia. Hear the word Adelphia, it comes from adophos. Philo phileos comes from brotherly love. It's the city of brotherly love, amen, the church of Philadelphia. But adophos, I heard one Greek scholar say this years ago, he said it actually comes from a word that means from the same womb. That's how God sees you and I, as brothers. See, Satan loves division, divide and conquer. You know the power of unity? The unity of the Spirit now. I'm not talking about a conformity, but it's so powerful. That's why Jesus said, a new commandment I give you. Not an additional commandment, but a new one. That you love one another. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples. In other words, you'll start changing the world. The greatest miracle the world's waiting to see is people that legitimately love one another and don't throw people off to the side when they don't meet up to their great understanding. Amen. Praise God. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as you have received of us, how you ought to walk and please God. I thought we were already pleased. I thought I'm already pleasing to God. You are, as a child of God. But there's a walk that's pleasing. Once again, so you would abound more and more. Now stop. Once again, is this vertical or horizontal? Obviously horizontal. Now I want this one from the, well, I'm going to take it from the King James just to rock your world. 2 Corinthians 5:9. We'll do that one. We're just about done. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. Vertical has to do with a God-word connection. It's an identity. It's who you are in Christ. Horizontal has to do with how much of that walk manifests in this world. Now, I love my children whether they're obedient or not. Do you know that? If you have more than one child, you love them both, correct? Or 10 or 20 or how many ever you have. You love them equally, correct? But how many of you know that there are certain behavior that's more pleasing? When they operate, you know, the word son in the book of Proverbs, when it says my son, you know what that means? Builder of the family name. Don't you love the languages? I tell you, the more you get into the Word of God, the more you see how divine it is. And I've determined this. I'm crazy not to sell out. I'm nuts if I don't. Because it's all in Him. Everything I'm looking for is in Him. The world screams at you, you're crazy. That's why I need my feet washed. That's why you need your feet washed. You're not crazy. Amen? Hallelujah. All right. Wherefore we labor. He's talking about being absent from the body, physical bodies, to be present with the Lord. Now, does that mean God's not with us? No, He is with us. But in fullness, as long as we're in these physical bodies, we see in part and we know in part. To be absent from the body, that we may be accepted of Him. Can I have the New King James? I don't care for that translation right there, because therefore we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to Him. Now, question, is this vertical or horizontal? It's horizontal. Amen? This chapter actually talks about the Bema seat, where we stand before the Lord, the believers. And there will be rewards. And I believe those rewards will involve people. Because, man, I made a decision to let the love of Christ that's been shed abroad in my heart by the Holy Ghost, Romans 5:5, I let the love of Christ that constrains, compels, or motivates me, that I already am and have in Him, 2 Corinthians 5:14, just a few verses down, I've let it motivate me. Daniel chapter 12, verse 3. KJV, if you don't mind. You guys are good. Daniel chapter 12. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. I want a big picture mentality. Amen? The big picture. Amen? Heaven starts right now. And it starts with an understanding of who you are. What was that? Who are you? Was that a Clint Eastwood, High Plains Drifter? What was that? See, I remember that. I'm not going to act like I don't. Was that what it was? Who are you? Well, that's what God knows who you are. The devil knows who you are. The devil's only fear is that you find out who you are. Did you hear what I just said? And if you find out who you are, see, that's what God's trying to convince us, not to do something to be something, but to operate in who we are, which will motivate us to do. Galatians 5:5, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, and temperance or self-control. Against such there is no law. Who is that? Is that who you are? Yes, it's vertical, but it also manifests in horizontally in what I do and how I walk. So we need to understand, vertical, my position in Christ. I'm a son of the King. I'm a child of the Most High God. I'm blessed and highly favored. I'm successful, but I'm not here just to get as much as I can, to get all I can get, can all I get, and sit on the can. Amen. I'm not here for that. I'm here to let the rivers flow on hurting humanity. And so are you. Amen. So are you. Once again, if it was just about my own self and just about me, then I may as well just go home. There's no reason to stay here because heaven will trump all this a bazillion times. It really will. But I'm not here for that. I'm here for you. I'm here for other people. I'm here to say, Lord, what do you want me to do? And it's not someday, it's today. The Lord really dealt with me last week. You know, I've been talking about writing a book. Someday. It's not someday, it's today. I'm cooking, baby. By the end of the summer, I'm going to have a manuscript done. I'm believing that. I figured 5 pages a week. If you took 5 pages a week, 52 weeks a year, that's 520 pages. Half that's 250. So you're looking at six months or so. I'm going to have it. The first one's going to be Proverbs through the eyes of grace. And it's powerful. It's powerful. And I'm writing it, and I'm just going to do it. I'm just going to respond to what God has given me. I'm going to stop waiting for my ship to come in while I hang out at the airport. Amen. Amen. Praise God. But see, that's not just me. That's every one of us. Every single person in here is called to be a world changer. Every single person. You know why? If the princes of this world had known. Man, I got to say this. This is prophetic right here. In 1 Corinthians 2. If they would have known what crucifying Jesus would do. You know what it did? It produced billions of Jesuses throughout the world. Amen. That's what it did. And see, they didn't know that. So now the only hope the enemy's got is to deceive the body into not knowing who they are. And if they're deceived into not knowing who they are, or they got to get to some level, then guess what? They're sitting there trying to get to some level, trying to figure out the faith combination. Jesus got it right. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. That gets me so excited, I can't hardly stand it. Amen. Anybody here not born again? Amen.